Welcome y'all to Introduction to Lesson 17. We are now transitioning away from non-singular linear systems into general linear systems. The first part of this video is going to be focused on defining the general linear systems problems. And then we're going to take a look at the similarities and differences between general linear systems and non-singular linear systems. Let's start with the problem statement. I love to break down problem statements by individual assumptions, and so I'm going to do that in this video. When we're defining the general linear systems problem, or what I like to call the GLSP, general linear systems problem, we're going to start with two natural numbers, aka positive integers. We'll call them M as in mango and N as in November. We also suppose that we're given a rectangular matrix A that has M rows and N columns. When we say given, what we actually mean is that we've constructed this matrix through a modeling context, and we'll see that in the examples from this lesson. The other thing that we are quote unquote given is a right-hand side vector B that has M rows. In this situation, when I'm typing vectors, I actually use boldface type. I don't tend to write that. If I was physically writing this, you'll see that I try to put a little vector hat on top of that. But when you see typed work with boldface, that means that it's a vector. All right, so we're given the dimensions of both matrices and vectors. So I have a single matrix A, I have a single vector B. The general linear systems problem is to find all unknown vectors x such that ax equals b. Notice that this problem statement looks very, very similar to the non-singular linear system, so much so that I think it's really important that we discuss the similarities and differences between those two problems. Here we are. We have both the non-singular linear systems problem that we studied in lessons 12, 13, 14, and 15. We also have the general linear systems problems. Let's begin analyzing these problems by specifically writing the dimensions. So in the non-singular linear systems problem, we said that the matrix A was an N by N matrix, and the matrix B was an N by one vector. We had something very, very special happening with the matrix A. We said that the thing was gonna be square, so the number of rows equals the number of columns, and non-singular. Not only does the number of rows equal the number of columns, but all the columns of that matrix are linearly independent. We had a bunch of different conditions to talk about that, but that was the one that we used to introduce the idea. The vector x in this situation was going to be n by 1, since when we multiplied an n by 1, the inner dimensions must agree. N equals n, those cancel out, and we're left with a vector of the size on the right-hand side. One of the really interesting features about the non-singular linear systems problem that we saw is this thing had a unique solution. There is only one way that we could take the columns of A as a linear combination to produce the vector B. On the other hand, when we look at the general linear system, the matrix A no longer has to be non-singular. Moreover, it doesn't even have to be square. Remember, all non-singular matrices must be square. Not all square matrices are non-singular. The moment that I know that this matrix is generally rectangular, that M does not have to be equal to N, that the number of rows doesn't have to be equal to the number of columns, I can immediately say, oh, that's probably not non-singular. Here, the moment that we have this, the inner dimensions must agree. We said that the vector X was going to be an N by 1. We see those inner dimensions agree, they'll cancel out, and we're left with a vector on the right-hand side. In this case, this is gonna be rectangular, and thus not even a candidate for non-singularity. We don't even get to consider if it's non-singular. Only square matrices can be non-singular. That is a primary difference. Another major difference is, generally, if B is a linear combination of the columns of A, we're gonna say that there are many solutions. More than just many, we're gonna say an infinite number. as we get into the technology of how to solve general linear systems, we're going to figure out exactly how to classify all possible solutions. Let's recap. Non-singular linear systems problem starts with a square non-singular matrix. Always has a unique solution. It will always happen that way. Rectangular matrix associated with the general linear systems. When B is a linear combination of the columns of A, we say that there are probably infinite number of solutions to this particular problem. I say probably because that's not always true. If this was a tall, thin matrix, it could be the case that all of the columns are linearly independent. We'll get into those conditions when we start talking about rank and we start analyzing specifically what it means to have linearly independent columns in all the different contexts. The last thing that I'll mention is that the right-hand side vector B in both of these problems, we assume that to be a linear combination of the columns of A. That assumption implies immediately we should be able to find at least one vector when we scale these particular columns that produces B. Another way to say that using the technology from lesson 6 is that B is assumed to be in the span of the individual columns of our matrix. The last thing I want to do is leave you with a little visual to give some intuition as we build this technology to generalize from non-singular linear systems problems. Remember, the shape of a non-singular linear systems problem involves a square matrix and a right-hand side vector. What we're going to see in this set of videos, though, is that sometimes, even if we start with a square matrix, the corresponding linear systems problems might not be non-singular. The only time a square matrix yields a non-singular linear systems problem is if the matrix itself is non-singular. So the general template, anytime we have a linear systems problem, a matrix that's given and a right-hand side vector that's given, aka they come from modeling, that could be either non-singular linear systems problem or a general linear systems problem, assuming, of course, that the right-hand side vector can be written as a linear combination of the columns of our matrix. Let's contrast this with the first type of linear systems that does not directly fit into the square paradigm, which is what we call the short-wide matrix. This type of system where I have a rectangular matrix with more columns than rows, we generally classify those as general linear systems. This is always, always, always under the condition that the right-hand side vector can be written as a linear combination of the columns of the matrix A. In this case, when we see a situation like this, we're usually thinking that the system has an infinite number of solutions. In fact, the moment I know this thing is in the span of the columns, it must be that these matrices yield an infinite number of solutions, an infinite number of vectors that can be taken, multiplied on the right-hand side of the matrix A to produce the vector B. The last type of problem that we might see that we'd call a general linear system is when we have a tall, thin matrix. Now, the moment I have a tall, thin matrix, I know the thing cannot be non-singular. So it's either a general linear systems or a least squares problem. This is the first time that we've assumed in least squares, the matrix A may not be able to produce the vector B through linear combinations. That is also true in these situations, but it's particularly relevant when we have more rows than columns, and we'll see that when we start talking about the ideas of overdetermined and underdetermined. I'm gonna go out on a limb and say, based on intuition, most times when we're thinking about the general linear systems problem, we're thinking about short, wide matrices that produce an infinite number of solutions. Here's a claim: if we wanna find a unique particular solution, we can usually map back systems that look like this into one of these two paradigms by deleting linearly dependent columns of our original matrix. We'll talk more about that as we get into it, but I wanted to kind of sift through some of those ideas and set us up for success in our future. All right, in the next video, we're going to talk about the strategy we're going to use to solve general linear systems problems and map it back to the same strategy we've seen before. See you there.